Let's turn the recording on. This thing always gets me. There we go. Okay, I'm glad we have more time to talk about Solomon tonight. Caleb, last time I thought I had to cover Solomon and David all in one night, and I didn't do so well. I covered David pretty well and Solomon a little bit. But tonight is just King Solomon. Is that fan bothering? The fan behind me?
No.
Okay. It says, during Solomon's lifetime, Judah and Israel lived in safety from Dan even to Beersheba, all of them under their vines and their fig trees. If you look on the map here, Dan is way up here. And Beersheba is down here. And so when it, throughout the Chronicles and Kings, it talks about from Dan to Beersheba many times. And it's interesting to note that on the other side of the Jordan, which is today called Jordan, that initially was part of Israel. So we have Judah down here. So David ruled 7 years in Judah. Then he made a deal with the other 10 tribes. And he ruled his lifetime and Solomon's lifetime over all of Israel. And it was called Judah at first and Israel. Then it was called Israel during the time of David and Solomon. And then after the time of Solomon, it was called Israel and Judah again. But Israel was sometimes called Ephraim or Ephraim. So here's a kind of a map of the land, the Philistines. They were never able to conquer the Philistines. And so they're down here on the Gaza Strip. And that's where the Palestinians still are. They're also on the West Bank, which is on this side of Jordan. And this is Jordan today. And up here, it's Caesarea Philippi. That's where Jesus was when Peter made the proclamation, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." So up here is Syria. At that time, Phoenicia is over here. This is the area of Lebanon today. And so during Solomon's time, Judah and Israel lived safely. There was no war. And the reason that there was no war is because Solomon had an extremely powerful army. And he really was the world leader at this time. All of the kingdoms that surrounded him brought tribute to him, and he became fabulously rich. It says in one place that silver was considered as the stones of the street. Nobody would take anything except gold during his reign. So let's talk about his reign a little bit. Here's a law for kings. It's found in Deuteronomy. You have to wonder if this was written at the time of Moses or if it's an addition to the book of Deuteronomy from a scribe later on. One thing is for sure, in the last sentence of it, it talks about Israel. It doesn't mention Judah. And so it's talking about kings of Judah, however, it mentions Israel. So it's probably either before David, or it might be after Solomon. But the point is, this is the law for the kings. And it's different from other kings. Now, you'll recall that we talked a couple of weeks ago about the people wanting a king, and Samuel didn't want to anoint a king. And God didn't want a king, but he allowed them to have a king by permission. This is where you kind of get the idea of the permissive will of God. You know, God has a perfect will and a permissive will. And so they wanted a king. And he told Samuel to anoint Saul as the king. And Saul did it out of obedience, but he didn't want to. But according to this passage, if it indeed is part of Moses' record, and I think it likely is, a king is allowed. When you've come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you and have taken possession of it and settled in it, you say, I'll set a king over me like all the other nations. You may indeed set a king set over you a king whom the Lord your God will choose. And so I guess the problem with Saul is that God didn't choose him. One of your community you may set as king over you. You're not permitted to put a foreigner over you who is not of your own community. Even so, he must not acquire many horses for himself or return the people to Egypt in order to acquire more horses, since the Lord has said, you must never return that way again. He must not acquire many wives for himself, or else his heart will turn away. Also, gold, silver and gold he must not acquire in great quantity for himself. And so these are the things that Solomon actually did and the things that brought about his downfall in the end. The interesting part is verse 18. When he has taken the throne of the kingdom, he shall have a copy of this law written for him. So here, you know, this, you know, within the text itself says that this is part of the law of Moses. In the presence of the Levitical priest, he shall remain with him and he shall read it all the days of his life. So they may learn to fear the Lord as God, diligently observing all the words. I have to move my thing so I can see here. All the words of the laws and statutes, neither exalting himself above other members of the community, nor turning aside from the commandment, either to the right or to the left, so that he and his descendants may reign long over his kingdom, Israel. So we see that the law of the king is, number one, he must be a Bible reader. He must not return anybody to Egypt. He must not acquire many horses. He must not acquire much gold. He must not acquire many wives. And if he follows these rules, his descendants may reign long. Now, in light of what we talked about last week, where the descendants of David would always have a king on the throne, here is a section which shows that for this to continue is conditional. Just like people when they come to know the Lord, you know, it's conditional in the sense that as long as you stay on the path, you're safe. But the minute you turn from observing the words of the law, then you're not safe. And so this is a complimentary look at the son of David. Any comments on this, or do you see anything in here that I haven't mentioned?
Well, if God didn't, if it didn't please God to have multiple wives, why would he even say he must not acquire many wives for himself? Why didn't he just say you can only have one wife?
Well, throughout the scripture, the early scriptures, that there's a mitigating quality to the law. All the people around were sacrificing their firstborn, so the law is, no, you don't sacrifice the firstborn, you substitute an animal instead. All the people around had slaves, and so the law said, okay, if you have a slave, you have to let the slave go after 7 years, and you have to let him go with the house. So a lot of these laws are, they're bringing closer to God's will. It's not getting there all the way. It's like in the New Testament when Paul says to the slaves, serve your masters as if you're serving Jesus himself. It was a condition in the Roman Empire that there was no way of changing at the time. And so because, you know, polygamy from the start, I mean, we saw it with Cain right in the beginning. He took two wives. And, you know, from the start, well, not from the start, because Jesus said in the beginning, you know, a man should leave a father and mother and cleave to his wife. So in the beginning, it was not so. Because they were talking about the permissibility of divorcing a wife, which is a...
Well, Moses himself had more than one wife.
Yes, he did. And Abraham did as well. And so did Jacob. Did Isaac? I think Isaac only had one wife.
That I ever read.
I think so. Might be wrong on that. So it was the thing for people to have more than one wife. But Solomon ended up having, I think, 800 wives.
Seven.
700?
300 concubines and 700 wives, I think. So there was 1,000.
So he could get with each of them once every 3 years. If he was able to do it every day. So, you know, some of the wives were not even probably women that he cohabited with. But he had married all kinds of women from the foreign countries who brought their gods into Jerusalem and caused a downfall, caused idolatry. So I guess the simple answer is that it's just a mitigating, it's making it better than it was. Although not the best. Does that satisfy your answer? I don't think it does.
No, because it seems like God could very well say, you know, just like he has qualities for elders, you know, mm-hmm. He could very well have said one wife, period. That's it.
He didn't, though, that we know of. Are you trying to turn me off, Matt?
No, I just had a question. Back in that day, there's so many men killed in war that there might have been a 2 to 3 women for every man, and there was maybe no welfare, so the women would be destitute if they didn't have a husband to support them.
That's definitely a consideration.
Coming from a man.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Well, what happens, you're in that culture.
Yeah.
And your father owns you. And your parents die. And there's nobody to marry. Then what do you do?
Yeah, I get it. But when you're explaining that to someone else, it's kind of a hard sell, giving them these reasons.
Well, they're totally uneducated. Because they didn't educate the girls. And so because of their culture, there's really nothing that a woman can do except extremely menial labor or prostitution. And so that doesn't make it right, but it's just the way that it was and the way that it is. Certainly, you know, Christianity has brought women out of that. And Christianity has brought people out of slavery too, because when you look at the, you know, at the teaching of the gospel that, you know, everybody is on the same plane, and it's even in this law for kings, the king isn't to be anybody special. He's not to be better than the others who are around. It's pretty clear in that passage that it's a different kind of king than the kings that are around them. But Solomon failed miserably at being a king, even though he was theoretically the smartest, the most wise person that ever lived, but he wasn't too wise in his own personal life. He may have known better, but didn't live by it. Maybe he had a lust spirit. I don't know. So it's not a good answer. I know that, but it's only one that.
Well, we know it's used as an excuse for polygamy. You know, if somebody's, well, look what they did, and it was okay with God. You know, well, it wasn't okay with God, but here's proof here that it was allowed.
Mm-hmm. Well, from the beginning, Jesus said, you know, they're talking about divorce. By the time the New Testament is there, there is no polygamy in Israel. And so is it lawful to divorce your wife for any reason? Shammai said, if she burns the dinner, get rid of her. And Hillel said, no, you can't divorce her for any reason except adultery. And so you have to understand that the same situation is there. A woman was basically sold by her father, and she has nothing else that she can do. If he divorces her, she has to go back to her father. And if her father isn't living and her brothers don't take care of her, you know, it's just a very heartless thing to do. And a woman could not divorce her husband. Mm-hmm. That was just the way the culture was.
I think, isn't it still like that in some of the Muslim countries?
Well, they would more follow Shammai. All they have to do is say, I think three times, I divorce you, I divorce you, I divorce you.
But I don't think women can divorce. I think only the men can, right?
I'm not 100% sure, but that's probably true. I mean, if you're born into a Muslim culture and you're a woman, God help you.
Exactly.
And I don't know why all these liberals are defending the Muslim way of life. It's not a good way of life. They can have up to 7 wives if they can afford it.
Kevin, I have a question. Back a couple chapters, I think it's chapter 2, when Adonijah went to Bathsheba and asked her to intervene and get the permission for him to marry the Shunammite woman. Why was that treasonous, and why did he have him killed along with everything else he did?
I'm going to have to say, without looking at that again, I don't remember.
Was that one of his wives? Was the Shunammite woman?
Read it to me, because I...
Okay.
You know, I haven't read this in years. And...
Okay, that's okay. So King Solomon went to Bathsheba to speak to him on behalf of Adonijah. And then down farther on verse 21, let Abishag the Shunammite be given to Adonijah, your brother, as his wife. King Solomon answered his mother, why should I give Abishag the Shunammite to Adonijah? He's my older brother, and on his side are Abathar and Joab. And then it goes on further. Because of this, God do so to me more if this word does not cost Adonijah his life. And then he says later on in verse 25, so King Solomon sent Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, and he struck him down and he died. So he actually killed him because of it. But I don't understand what was
the condition. Adonijah wanted to be the king.
Right.
And there was some stuff going on in the background. And so I think his mother said to him, ask your brother for the woman. And so the idea here, he says Joab is with him. Now, Joab was David's chief of staff, or, you know, military right. guy, head military guy.
Right.
And so he's thinking that there's intrigue here to make Adonijah king and to get rid of Solomon. Okay. And so eventually they went to David and said, you know, which one should be king? And he said, Solomon should be king. Mm-hmm. And so, in this nice little family of David's, here we have another, right. another murder.
Okay.
So he was afraid he was going to lose the kingdom.
Okay. But it doesn't really say why this one woman caused him to really.
I'm trying to remember. I think she may have been another daughter of David.
Oh, okay.
I'll look it up and see if I can get more information.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, sorry, I don't have a good answer for
That's
you
okay.
right now. You know, I'm getting older and I forget all these stories.
Well, I think it had to cause a lot of unrest in the family with Solomon next in line to be heir, because
he was younger.
Right, he was younger, and Bathsheba came along later as one of the wives. And so, right. you know, his first wife, generally, you know, their sons would be in line for the kingship. And in this case, it was...
Well, his first wife was Michael, Saul's daughter. Mm-hmm. But she didn't have any kids.
And then, you know, so I think a lot of them probably felt that they were more justified than Solomon.
Mm-hmm. Well, they all wanted it. And they all, Absalom, before this, you know, got a political party going and actually drove his father out of Jerusalem. So, you know, politics is a nasty business.
Especially in the family.
Look at this. Oh, no, I shut it. Hold on a second. You have to open PowerPoint again. This doesn't like it when something is please excuse my ignorance. I'm afraid to close this thing. Can you see the screen?
It says Zoom.
The Zoom screen.
You don't see the birth of Solomon?
Nope. You want us to log out and log back in?
No. It's on my end.
Oh, okay.
You see it now?
Yes.
Okay.
Good job.
There's too many buttons on this thing. Okay, let's talk about Bathsheba, who is Solomon's mother. Her name means the daughter of the oath or the daughter of the covenant. It's a really good name. And this woman ends up being the mother of Solomon. But when we first see her, she is married to a special forces guy named Uriah the Hittite. So what do we know about her based on this right off the bat? She's married to a non-Jew, and they were forbidden to intermarry. But she sees this guy, Uriah, who is David's special forces guy, works with Joab, is fearless. And so she sees this military guy, and he's got all kinds of medals and decorations and stuff like that. And so she marries outside of Judaism.
But she would have had to have her father's permission.
Yes. And she probably was sold by her father. But let's suppose, no matter how it happened, let's suppose she didn't disobey God in a mixed marriage. How would the story be different?
The first child wouldn't have died.
Well, perhaps she could have married David directly. She's around. How do I know she's around? I know she's around because her grandfather is Ahithophel, and Ahithophel is David's number one counselor. So she and her family are on the inside of David's kingdom. So she sees Uriah. Uriah sees her. She's beautiful. And they get married. And Uriah is off at war with Joab. And David is looking down from the parapet of his castle. So we know that she's living, you know, adjacent to the king's castle. And she's sunbathing out there. And so David gets this idea. She looks pretty good. So he calls for her. And she comes and he commits adultery with her and she gets pregnant. And so you know the story. David sends to Joab, send Uriah back here. So Uriah comes back and he doesn't go to his own house. He sleeps outside and refuses to go into his own house. Because his brothers are fighting on the battlefield. And so David's plan to trick Uriah into thinking that the illegitimate child of Bathsheba is his own, it doesn't work. So he writes a letter and he seals it so that it can't be opened. And it says, and send this here, give this to Joab. He gives the death warrant for Uriah to his own hand to take to Joab, who is not a godly person either. And it says, when the battle gets fierce, back up from Uriah and let the enemy kill him.
Right, puts it in writing.
What's it in writing? And Joab does it. And when Nathan comes and rebukes David for this, David repents of it. But it sets into motion a disruption in the country and a disruption in the family of David like you can't believe. First of all, Ahithophel, his counselor, who is the grandfather of this girl, becomes infuriated. Now, if you read the story, it doesn't say why Ahithophel did this. But if you look at the genealogy in Chronicles, you find out that he is her grandfather. So it's not good to skip over the genealogies if you're doing a real study. And so Ahithophel gets in league with Absalom and the baby gets sick and is ready to die. David does fasting and prayer, but it doesn't do any good. The baby dies. And Absalom becomes, I should be king. Look at this crap my father did. Ahithophel says, I'll help you. And it set into motion the death of Absalom. And it set in motion David being chased out of his own kingdom by his own son. And some of those Psalms are probably written about that. And it all happened because David thought that it'd be a good idea to have sex with a girl he saw sunbathing outside his castle. So, Uriah's dead, Bathsheba becomes David's wife, and Solomon is conceived, and David named him Jedidiah. But he was always known as Solomon. I don't know if this name was given to him during his reign or after his reign or at the time. I don't know. But Solomon is the word from which we get the word shalom, which means shalom, peace, wellness, everything is well. And that was the way his kingdom was. There was no war. The economy was great. A lot of things were going well for those who were on the inside. However, it was not a just society.
I ask a question?
You may.
You said sunbathing as opposed to bathing. How do you know that?
I don't.
Oh.
it just says bathing, right?
Yeah. I mean, okay. I've not heard that before.
Well, it's hard to get clean in the sun, so.
Well, but many times they were on the rooftop. You've been to India because it's so hot. So they would sleep on the roofs and she was probably bathing up there as well, because it's so hot that she was probably up on the rooftop.
Well, it's not likely there was a pool up there.
No, but there was probably water to cool down by. It doesn't say exactly what time of day. So, and generally people weren't laying around in the sun back then either.
Yeah, they may have been if they were, you know, upper echelon people.
It says late one afternoon.
Okay. Dinner time.
Yes, because I hadn't heard that before. Okay.
If it says bathing, that's what it says.
People with darker skin prefer not to get darker too.
Well, if you look at the Song of Solomon, it says that his lover is black.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
From Ethiopia.
Well, the Shunammite. So I don't know who the Shunammite is, but it could have been somebody from Ethiopia. Okay. Good question and good point. We looked at this last week. We looked at the whole verses 3 through 14. How Solomon asked for wisdom, and God said, well, that's a good thing, because long life and riches and protection from enemies are the fruit of wisdom. Like, hey, it might not be a good idea to go 85 miles an hour in that car. It might not be a good idea to try that heroin. It might not be a good idea if you're in a family of alcoholics to start drinking. It might not be a good idea to pick a fight with a big guy from another culture. It might not be a bad idea to work 6 days and save your money and divide and invest. You know, so the things of wisdom which are found in written in the book of Proverbs, if we follow those things, chances are, not guaranteed, of course, because there's all kinds of things that could possibly happen. But chances are, if you follow the wisdom that is written in Solomon's Proverbs, you're probably going to have a longer life, and you're probably going to have more money. You're probably not going to be in debt. I don't know what I just kicked over, but it was loud. So I just wanted to mention that before we went on. Now let's talk about wisdom in the New Testament. Oh, the depth of the riches both of wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and unfathomable his ways. So Paul sees Jesus as the wisdom of God. Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. So he says, who's known God's mind, and who became his counselor? Who gave him that he might be paid back again? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Now here's the most unfortunate chapter switch in the New Testament. Therefore, which refers to chapter 11 here. Therefore, I urge you, present by the mercies of God your body as a holy and living sacrifice. The wisest thing that a person can do is to present themselves as an offering to God. The whole idea, we're going to talk about temple in a minute, the whole idea of temple in the New Testament is that there is no temple. The only manifestation or the only house of God on the earth are the people of God. And so we'll get to that in a minute. James says, if you lack wisdom, ask God, he'll give to you abundantly. And Jesus said, the queen of the south will rise with this generation at the judgment and will condemn it, because she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. And behold, something greater than Solomon is here. Was this in your book, how the Queen of Sheba had come to meet with Solomon? Was that in the reading?
I read it. I don't know if it was in the book.
I think so. But yeah, I'm not sure where.
Yes, it was.
So the Queen of Sheba is the Queen of Ethiopia. And to this day, there is a black Jewish population in Ethiopia that dates back to this. And then there is a Christian group of black, presumably formerly Jewish people who heard the gospel from the, who was it? Was it Simon of Cyrene? Anyway, there was an Ethiopian that went back to Ethiopia, and there's a large church, and they had some really early artifacts that came on the market when Ethiopia had their famine a few years ago. Just great old Christian treasures and relics. So Jesus equates the people coming from a far country to hear the wisdom of Solomon. He's saying to the scribes and Pharisees, you should listen to what I have to say, because I have a greater wisdom than Solomon. Now here's a little different view of the temple. Solomon decided to build a temple for the name of the Lord and a royal palace for himself. I don't know what was wrong with the royal palace that David built, but Solomon needed a new one.
He needed room for all those wives.
Yeah, I guess so. So Solomon conscripted. What do you think another word for conscripted might be?
Slaves.
Solomon had 70,000 laborers and 80,000 stone cutters who were slaves, and 3,600 people to oversee them. This is not good. This is really a denial of everything that Moses taught. Because they were slaves in Egypt, and they did the Passover, they had within the Passover the tears of slavery, and that everybody should remember that they were formerly slaves, but God delivered them from slavery. And the teaching was clear in those books of Moses that the reason that the children of Israel were in Egypt in the first place is because the brothers of Israel sold Joseph into slavery. And so as a result, they became slaves for generations. And so in the Passover, they have to remember every year that they used to be slaves. The Passover is about the time where they come out from slavery. So now we have a king who thinks it's the best way to build the house of God is to enslave, well, 70 and 80 is how many? You know, that's 150,000 people working on the project. That's a pretty big building project. So Solomon sent word to the King Huram, who's called Hiram in other places. Once you dealt with my father and sent him cedar to build himself a house to live in, now I'm about to build a house for the name of the Lord, my God, and dedicate it to him and offer fragrant incense for regular offering and rows of bread and burn offerings. All the things that Moses prescribed for the tabernacle, he describes here. We're going to do it on in the morning. We're going to do it in the evening. We're going to do it on Sabbath day. We're going to do it on New Moon. We're going to do it on the festivals, on Passover and Pentecost and Tabernacles. And we're going to continue to do this forever, and it's going to be magnificent. So I need material. The house I'm about to build will be great, for our God is greater than other gods. But who is able to build him a house, since heaven, even the highest heaven, cannot contain him? And who am I to build a house for him except as a place to make offerings, peace offerings before him? One thing is clear. God never asked for this building to be built. In fact, in some places in the prophets, God says, I don't even like your offerings.
Yes.
So what did he do? He enslaved these people to build it. How do you think God felt about that? So we don't have a washstand. We have a tanker big enough to sit on the back of 12 full-size oxen. And we got little lavers to take the water out. And we didn't have a stone, or I guess it was a bronze one at the tabernacle too. We didn't have a small thing. We've got one that goes up by steps. And there's no tent. It's all cut stone. And the patio is all cut stone. And there are gold-covered pillars and doors. And inside, we don't have one seven-branch lampstand. We have seven seven-branch lampstands. And inside the Holy of Holies, we don't have a curtain. We have a gold-covered representation of the cherubim, which are on the Ark of the Covenant, which they still have at this time. But the only thing that was in it, it says, was the Ten Commandments, the testimony of the rod that budded and the manna from heaven. They were missing. And so he turns this into a huge building project and overlays the inside with gold paneling and ivory. And he spends, I don't know how much it costs to hire people for several years. Go ahead.
20 years it took just to build that, and then 13 years for his palace. He started his palace after the temple was built.
Now, it's interesting. At some point, we'll talk about this later, but this temple became the reason, in the mind of the invaders, the Babylonians, to come and destroy the city. Because I think it was Hezekiah, I can't remember exactly now, but we'll get to it in a later lesson. He brought the king of Babylon in and he showed him this building. And the guy went back and said, you know, we ought to go down there and take that. And they did. They came in and they tore it down. This is not the temple of the New Testament. This was torn down at the time of the Babylonian captivity, and all the gold was stripped out of it and taken to Babylon. And who knows, your wedding ring might be made out of it. You know,
I did read somewhere that they did such a good job, like taking every single piece out of there, that archaeologists have never even found a sliver of anything where that used to be of what was left of that temple. So they really did come in and destroy it and take everything.
So Herod, after the Babylonian captivity, decided to rebuild the temple, but the temple that Herod built was much larger and much less ornate. And Jesus said, tear down the temple and I will raise it up in 3 days. And they said, it took Herod 42 years to build this thing. What are you talking about? You're a madman. But he wasn't talking about the temple. He was talking about his body. He was talking about the temple in which he lived. And the idea in the New Testament, the temple of the Lord is the people of God. The Holy Spirit dwells within people. In the Old Testament, in the tabernacle, the Spirit of the Lord sat on the mercy seat, and there was smoke in the day and a pillar of fire by night. When this building was dedicated, it filled with the glory cloud as well, but it's not recorded that there was a pillar of fire on it anywhere. And God never asked for it to be built, but it was magnificent. Enter Jeroboam.
Yeah, Now, what are you kind of implying when you say, you know, God didn't ask for this?
God said, you know, God said in the prophets in different places, when did I ever ask for it? I can't give you a chapter and verse, but it's in there somewhere. Look in.
Yeah. But I mean, that kind of implies what? This was totally a man-made prideful thing?
Well, maybe. I mean, David wanted to build it, and God said, no, you're a man of war. And as we talked about last week, there's two interpretations of the Son of David. One interpretation is your son Solomon will build a house for you. And then the other interpretation is that some descendant will build the house. And it depends on if you read the account in Chronicles or Kings, which it was. Now, Solomon thought it meant that he was the promised son of David. But the other account of it says it can't be because the line of David is gone. So it has to be some future David. And then, so we have the genealogy in Matthew, which shows Joseph's genealogy, and the genealogy in Luke that shows Mary's genealogy, both descended from David. And so he is going to build the house. This is the one that will build the house, not Solomon. So there's two interpretations within the Bible and how they saw the prophecy. And, you know, at some point they had to say, hey, wait a minute. Everything's gone. The temple's gone. The kingly line is gone. Everybody's in captivity. The whole city's, the walls are torn down. The gold is stripped from the temple. So how do you go with this Son of David interpretation? And so they came up with the idea, rightly so, that it's going to be a further descendant of David, which was, in fact, Joseph. And also, Mary. Did you follow it?
I have a couple things. So, pre-Stone Temple, it was always a tent. And the idea of that was kind of the fact that God was mobile, right? It's like wherever the people went, the temple went.
Yes, but by the time of Samuel, it was in his side room. But initially, it was a mobile. But see, now they're in the land that the cloud and the fire were leading them to. They're now in the land. So this is a permanent place. That's the idea of permanence.
In Exodus 20, it says you should not make an altar of cut stones.
Yes, it does.
So I don't know that they didn't use cut stones, but from what it sounds like, this was a completely man-made cut stone, top of the line building.
Yeah, it was completely cut stone.
So, I didn't really fully think about it until you said that, hey, them building this was ultimately what led to their destruction by Babylon. But you're right. I don't recall God ever telling him to build this. I think he kind of allowed it. I picture it kind of like a kid wanting to build something for his dad, and it's completely terrible quality, but you're like, oh, okay, he means well. Let him build this thing for me out of Legos. And
I think he was totally convinced that he was the son of David and would build a temple. Solomon was.
Mm-hmm. But God, when David wanted to build the temple, God said, no, you're a man of war. He didn't say, no, it can't be built at all.
He said, your son will build it.
Right. And so, you know, that led them to believe that, okay, well, God said it's okay for the next generation to do it.
Right. Right. That's how they interpreted it. And right. that's how it is in the one account. And in the other account, it's talks about a future son of David. So it depends on, you know, it depends on the, Solomon certainly thought he was following God from the prophet of Nathan, who came to David and said, no, your son will build it. But the temple of God is the people of God. The building itself is nothing. It's like that, you know, we say it's the church. Well, the church are the people that worship inside the building. It's the same idea. Paul talks about building. I've laid the foundation. Let everyone be careful upon how they build. If they build with precious stones and so forth, the fire will reveal if they built it with straw or wood. The judgment, the fire will reveal it. We're builded up together to form a habitation for our God. I mean, this is all New Testament theology. And it really, with the burning of Herod's temple by Titus in the year 90, the Jews had to readjust all their theology too, because the temple is gone. And if the temple is gone, then the sacrifice can't be made. And so there is no animal sacrifice anymore, because there is no temple. If there was a temple, they would be offering sacrifices. So they take the egg and they burn the egg and they put it on the Passover plate and say, okay, we're doing the best we can. This is a sacrifice, but the temple is gone. So the burnt egg is representative of that. And we're following where we can follow. But since the priesthood has disappeared and since the house of God is gone, we can't follow the rule of Moses concerning worship.
Is where the temple was, is that where that huge, like,
mosque
is now?
That's what they say.
Yeah, okay.
That's what they say. There are some people that say that it isn't there.
Oh.
They say that it's adjacent to it and that it could be built right next to it.
Okay.
I thought the Wailing Wall was the foundation of the temple.
The Wailing Wall is the foundation of, I think it's on the backside, over near where Zion was. So it's the wall of the city, I believe, and the wall of the temple.
I wonder why they didn't go back to a tent tabernacle temple after the destruction of it.
That's an interesting thought. But the Wailing Wall, now Jesus said, not one stone will be left upon another. If that was actually part of the temple, There could be a further problem with the Wailing Wall, because there are still stones stacked there. You know, this is pure speculation. Anything else?
I was reading, I can't remember if it was the total of Solomon's gold or what was brought to him. I think it was the total amount. And it was almost $1 billion in gold that he had by today's standards.
By today's standards, or by the standard of the American gold double eagle?
Well, it doesn't really say that. It's something like $970 million.
There's a lot of conspiracy people that say that a lot of the gold is still hidden.
Yeah, there's people that say that it's not in Fort Knox like it's supposed to be.
I believe that.
Okay, we're running out of time, and I do want to get to this next one, Jeroboam. The man Jeroboam was very able, and when Solomon saw that the young man was industrious, he gave him charge over all the forced labor of the house of Joseph. So he's a slave driver, and he takes his job very seriously. He's very smart. He knows what to do. And so Solomon puts him in the job as chief oppressor of the slaves.
when he says the house, is this referring to Manasseh and Ephraim?
Yes.
Oh, so they're oppressing the smaller of the tribes?
The tribe of Joseph. Yeah, the two half-tribes. And he was actually from Ephraim himself, which is another name for Israel. I mean, in the technical sense, it's just the sons of Joseph, but later Israel became known as Ephraim to some. And so as we read about Ephraim in the prophets, it's talking about not necessarily just the half tribe of Joseph, but it's talking about the 10 lost tribes, so to speak. And so this is the guy who we will be talking about next week, because he is the first king of Israel. We talked about this last week. I just wanted to mention again. You can't mess around with God. And so once again, 3,000 Proverbs. We don't have them all. His songs were 1,005. We have exactly three of them. The Song of Solomon, which is the Song of Songs, his best song. And then there are two others that are mentioned as being Solomon's songs within the Psalms, 72 and 127. Three of the five books of Proverbs are said to be Solomon's Proverbs, and Ecclesiastes is, the Jews would say it wasn't written by Solomon, it was written by Koheleth, because that's what it says. It's translated in English as the preacher. So it might be that Solomon was called the preacher, because we don't have any record of Koheleth anywhere as being a king in Judah, and it says he was a king of Judah. So it would make sense that it's Solomon is calling himself the preacher in that book. It's an old, bitter man. The works of his younger days are in the Proverbs and in the Psalms, but if it was Solomon, the works of his older days are in the book of Ecclesiastes. Any questions or comments on anything? Keith never made it.
I think in some ways I'm getting more out of this one. I think because it's not all new to me, so I can look for different things this time when reading all of this than versus, 30 years ago when I was doing it.
Well, you're a little more mature these days.
A little, huh?
You're the one that said 30 years. It's been more than 40.
Oh, gosh. I'm just an old lady. Approaching 60, brain's going.
Are you all reading the book?
Yes.
Well, I hope you're enjoying it. I like doing this better than anything else. It's better than pastoral work because, this is what it says, make your own interpretation and use it any way you like, but it's not trying to lead people along. It's a little bit different.
I like doing it on Zoom. Having three little kids, it's really hard to load them up or find babysitters to go places. So it's a lot easier to just take an hour out of your day and do this than what ultimately becomes 3 hours if you have to get ready and transport and things
like that. I think the night Bible study is a thing of the past. I think it will continue. All this type of stuff will be done on some sort of platform like this.
It's probably nicer for the slump skis, right, you guys?
Oh, I love it. We love it. Yeah, for sure.
Hi, them.
I'm sorry?
Why did you say that? Do they live a long way from the church, or?
They're kind of self-isolated.
They're in Farmington.
Right. Although we would come, but considering the problems of the times with the COVID, we're staying put.
Yeah, they have to be careful. Matt has some health issues, but he's doing better.
God.
So, you know, he has to be very careful.
And I have a son that has to be very careful. He doesn't have a complete immune system. But he's taking chances.
Who's that, Deb?
I have two sons. My older son lives in Penfield. And when he was 13, we found out all his immune systems weren't working, only a few.
So, wow.
He has nothing to fight it with if he gets it. Nothing.
How old is he now?
40. And my son in Texas, who's 39, he just got the COVID and is over it. He's a respiratory therapist in a hospital in McKinney, and he got it.
Wow.
But he has
okay.
Yep, he has a strong immune system. It was mild. He never had a fever. So all those signs they talk about and checking people's temperature, you know, that's not totally the safeguard.
Wow.
Yeah, he thought he had a sinus infection, and the doctor even said, you're just coming down with a cold.
Well, that's what Tally thought he had was just a cold.
Wow. I just talked to Tally, and he's definitely looking more like the flu.
I was talking to him during this. He said he's really, really tired, but he's still breathing okay. So
we're praying, you guys. We're praying.
Thanks.
So one of our kids has it.
Who?
Our son, Naftali, has COVID.
Oh.
So we're trying to figure out what to do. We didn't have church today. I mean, we had online church because we didn't know. We wanted to make sure everybody was safe. We wanted to get our other family members tested and see what's going on. So
now, where does he live?
Canandaigua.
Oh, local. Okay.
Yeah. Yep. Well, I think you're all great. Thank you for coming.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a good week, everybody.
We'll see ya.
Thanks so much. Bye-bye.